Your doctor has recommended that you have an EGD, also known as an upper GI endoscopy. This video will help you to understand this minimally invasive procedure. Let's begin by reviewing information about your body. The gastrointestinal GI tract begins with the mouth. This tract or path for digestion continues past the throat to the esophagus, a tube that carries food to the stomach. In the stomach, pieces of food are broken down further. These partially digested bits then pass to the duodenum, which is the first part of the small intestine. Together, these structures are considered the upper GI tract. EGD stands for the medical name of the procedure. E stands for esophagus, G for gastro, which means stomach, and D for duodenum. This procedure is done using a long, flexible instrument called a scope that has a light and camera at the tip. When necessary, tools can be guided through the scope to biopsy and treat this hard-to-reach area of the body. During this procedure, the lining of the upper GI tract is inspected to investigate symptoms and complaints, such as difficulty swallowing and heartburn. Abnormal tests, commonly anemia, and other suspected disease, such as celiac disease, ulcers, or cancer. Suspicious lesions may be removed or biopsied. If tissue samples are collected, they are sent to a pathology lab for examination. An EGD can be recommended as necessary to treat some problems. With an EGD, a doctor is often able to stop severe upper GI bleeding. In other situations, food chunks and other stuck objects can be reached and gently removed. An EGD can also be used to stretch and dilate an esophagus that is narrow from scar tissue or other problems. Now let's look closer at the EGD procedure. To start, you will be positioned comfortably and given medication to help you relax or sleep during the procedure. A scope is gently guided through your mouth and throat, then down your esophagus to your stomach. You may feel some pressure or tugging, but you shouldn't feel pain. And further to the first part of the small intestine. The walls of the upper digestive tract are carefully inspected. Small lesions may be removed for testing. After all of the surfaces have been examined, biopsies and necessary treatments completed, the scope is withdrawn. Now let's learn about what may occur after your procedure, some of the risks, and what you can do to help. It is important for you to speak up and tell your care team if you have more than expected pain or problems. They will be watching for early, rare complications. After the EGD, you may feel awake quickly. However, anesthesia medication used during the procedure to help you relax or sleep can impair your thinking for several hours. Some patients notice effects for days. If your procedure is done as an outpatient, understand that you will need a ride home. Plan to rest. Do not drive, operate machinery, make important decisions, or drink alcohol until the next day. You may be told to restrict your activity for 24 hours. Be sure you understand your personal instructions. After the EGD, your throat may be numb. You may have a sore throat, some gas pains, and cramping for a few days. Follow instructions about when you may begin eating and drinking after your procedure. It can be safe for some patients to start soon after. However, others may be advised to wait for a specific period of time. If you are admitted to the hospital after surgery, your length of stay will depend on the specific procedures that were performed, any new findings or unexpected outcomes, and your other medical conditions. Know what is planned for you so that you can prepare. Results and immediate findings of the procedure may be provided the same day. However, if tissue was sent for testing, the biopsy results may not be available until a later date. Be certain you understand the outcome of your procedure and if or when you need to follow up with your care provider. For the best recovery, follow your instructions that may include information about safe use of medication, timing of return to normal activity, including walking, stairs, driving, and showering, and extra rest as needed to heal and recover from the anesthesia. Any procedure will make you more tired than you anticipate. You can help your body heal. Eat healthy foods. Avoid junk food, sugary drinks, and don't smoke. Smoking and high blood sugar slow healing. Rarely, serious problems may occur, such as a tear or an injury to the upper GI tract. Severe bleeding or infection may result. A blood clot or DVT can form in the legs or pelvis during or after any surgery. It can cause a lung complication called a PE or pulmonary embolism. Steps are taken by your care team to help avoid this complication. Your personal risk of complication relates to your overall health, the complexity of the procedure, and experience of your physician. Call your doctor if you have nausea, vomiting, a persistent cough, or pain that is getting worse, or a fever. Call 911 if you have chest pain, shortness of breath, dizziness, bleeding that doesn't stop, and any other sign that you may be having a complication from the procedure. Hospital admission, medication, or surgery may be needed to correct some problems. Now let's talk about your responsibility. To avoid cancellation or complications from anesthesia or your procedure, your job as the patient is to not eat, drink, or chew gum after midnight, the night before the procedure, unless you are given different instructions. Take only medications you were told to on the morning of the procedure with a sip of water. Follow instructions regarding aspirin and blood thinners, and arrive on time. You should be ready to verify or confirm your list of medical problems and surgeries, all of your medications, including vitamins and supplements, your current smoking, alcohol, and drug use, and all allergies, especially to medications, latex, and tape. All surgical procedures and anesthesia have a small but possible risk of serious injury, even some problems very rarely leading to death. It is your job to speak up and ask your doctor if you still have questions about why this procedure is being recommended for you, the risks, and alternatives. This video is intended as a tool to help you better understand the procedure that you are scheduled to have or are considering. It is not intended to replace any discussion, decision-making, or advice of your physician.